Thank you to the Patreon supporters of the What We Remember podcast. Sarah P., a.k.a. Situational Daddy on Instagram, Paul and Sandy J., Nathan E., Jacqueline M., Matthew J., and Big Time Jim. Help support our show by going to patreon.com/whatweremember. Thanks.
We need more Angela Lansbury type characters, you know?
That's true. I heard the other day.
You know the
Brad,
movie.
Have you heard of Knives Out?
Do you know the movie Gaslight?
Yeah, I've heard of it. And I have not seen it.
Telling him about the movie Gaslight, but then I don't.
Brad, I've seen it. You keep telling me I haven't seen it, but I think I've seen it.
So that word Gaslight comes from the movie because that's the plot of the movie.
Yeah.
Angela Lansbury's in that movie. And it's from like the 1940s.
You know, she gets around.
Prolific career.
She gets around. And then she gets right around. And then she rode around.
So we got to 150 of these episodes somehow.
Christ. That's a surprise.
I feel so old.
It's been like 6 years.
That's huge.
I'm doing this show.
What's the Titanic meme?
That's 25 movies every year.
Man, it's a lot of movies, man. Do you think do we have any movies left? I feel like we've done all of them. Every movie.
Done 150
ever.
Movies. And even a couple others that never were released.
Or released in other ways.
Or poorly released. I mean, because the quality's poor.
All right, we're going to transition. We're just going to start doing YouTube videos.
That's what this is.
No, review. We remember about YouTube videos we watched.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Yeah, we should just do that instead. But I figure we should just do our namesake. It's in the title of the episode. Every episode up until now.
And we did the other one. We've done Home Alone.
Home Alone was done early.
So let's hit the other one that's in the title.
There's only two in the title?
Yeah. Obviously, you listen to the show.
Yeah.
It's been a while. Like years.
Wow.
It was fun at first, but then I ran out of time.
Yeah. I agree. Also, editing them. It's like, I don't listen to
that's true.
Again.
When you edit it,
you're
listening to them.
I don't want to listen to this again.
Fair enough. I guess I'm the only one. I think
you
we're
still
hilarious.
Listen to us?
We have one viewer. Yeah, it's him.
It's me every time.
You got
why
one
are
listener.
We doing this?
I love when these come out.
It's like a.
It's my favorite thing.
It's like a snake
Andy
eating its own tail.
He's in it. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I'm like, these guys are so funny.
Especially the guy with the beard.
Wonder if he's single.
Ooh. Actually, their bits are definitely. I'm like, we're funny.
Yeah, yeah. We try.
Maybe that's not good to say.
We're funny.
Humble,
I think we're good.
It's like you're the drunk girl at a party. I'm funny.
I'm just
funny.
A funny guy. I'm the funny one.
I'm the funny one.
Everyone says I'm the funny one.
And I'm the hot one, too.
Oh,
no, you're not.
No, you're not.
But
I can tell you what. My name is Bradley Jones.
I'm Andrew Moldenhauer.
And I'm Andy Hubert.
And this is not a movie review podcast, but it's a podcast where we try to remember a movie that we haven't seen in a very, very long time. And this is what we remember about Finding Nemo.
Were there two or three bad guys in Home Alone? And who was that forgetful fish in Finding Nemo? Join us as we're watching films. See what we remember and what memories we kill. Let's start the show. Here we go. This is what we remember.
Yeah.
It's in the theme song.
Who was
it's been a while since I've seen this one.
Forgetful fish.
Sure.
Dory.
Oh, Brad.
I knew
spoilers.
The whole time. God, I knew the whole.
Damn.
She had her own movie.
That's true.
Yeah,
just called Dory.
Dory goes to
Finding
Dory. Pig in the City? Is that the one?
Finding Dory.
Oh, that's right.
There's some ridiculous things in that Dory movie. There's an octopus driving a truck. I don't know.
Hey,
what's
have you
happening.
Seen some of those videos of octopi going nuts? Like, they are crazy smart.
Going nuts.
Dude, like, they'll break,
getting out of, yeah, getting
out of their tanks and, like, doing crazy shit.
It doesn't drive a car.
Are you sure? I bet that exists somewhere.
I mean, if I was going to have one sea animal drive a car, it'd probably be an octopus.
Yeah.
So.
Makes sense. They're really smart.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy.
Who was in this movie?
Isn't it Albert Brooks?
Yeah. But there's fish, though, so.
Yes, that's true. We got Ellen DeGeneres.
Yes.
Willem Dafoe?
Is he in this?
Mm-hmm.
We got the guy who's in every Pixar movie. He plays, I think, the Stingray.
Rosenberg?
Yeah.
Rosenblatt?
Rosenblatt.
Gardenhauser.
Gardenhauser.
Oh.
Who else? I don't know. Actually.
Will Smith is the shark with Jack Black, not Shark
Tales. Yeah, I literally had that same idea. I was like, Will Smith, but no, that's Shark Tales.
Which came out almost, real soon after Finding Nemo.
I almost want to say the shark that's is true. Like Idris Elba or something. The voice feels very similar.
The shark is scary.
It is.
I think there's like a surfer turtle.
Dennis Leary's a in turtle. This, I think. He's one of the fish at the dentist's office.
Okay.
Who's a turtle?
Oh, I don't know. It's some
you Crush.
Know. Yeah.
Crush guy.
Surfer dude.
Why do I know that? That's the name. I don't know. These things just come to me. I'm a genius.
I'm Crush.
A genius or just holding on to information that you should have let go
surf me, bro.
A long time ago? Yeah.
Surf me, bro.
Orange Crush, y'all.
Orange Crush. It's my crush. My grandma loves Orange Crush.
It's good.
Oh, I think it. The brother from Everyone Loves Raymond. Brad.
Yes, Raymond.
Yes, he's in it.
The Pufferfish.
The Ring of Fire.
Yeah.
Dave Raymond.
Right. Is that where he sounds?
No.
He's like kind of obnoxious voice.
Do it, Raymond. It's like that. It's like more.
Raymond. Raymond. What's his name?
Brad something.
Renfro.
Brad Garrett.
Brad Garrett?
Yeah.
Brad Garrett. Brad got it. It's his namesake.
Yeah. I think
there's a lot of voice acting.
I think this was directed and written by Andrew Stanton. He's like there's like
got me.
There's like three main guys that did like the first eight Pixar movies. So I think he also did Monsters Inc.
Okay.
Is this like a original story?
Yeah.
Wow. That's fun.
Pixar was only doing originals for a
while. I mean, the retelling of Magnificent Seven is The Bug's Life.
Oh, come on. Okay. Come on. But every movie is a remake of Romeo and Juliet, Brad. Come on.
Is this movie a remake of Romeo and Juliet? I don't think so.
It is.
Because it's father clearly. Son. Trying to find
10 Things I Hate About You is not a remake of anything, it's original.
Totes original, dude.
So Nemo's mom gets eaten in the first like 5 minutes.
She dead
by a really? Barracuda or something. Somewhere
that sounds very right. Yeah, scary.
Barracuda.
Some long snouted.
Yep.
It's not like a revenge story where they're like they're gonna get.
Go
you know,
get it's that like barracuda. It's like a Land Before Time story.
They kind of just understand that they are not the top of the food
that's just
chain,
part of life,
and it's just like part of the world they live in, where they could get eaten any second.
Sure. Do clownfish go in schools or no? Schools of clownfish, or do they just hide?
I don't know. It sounds like they're just hiding in those sea anemones.
But because this happens, Albert Brooks is like super overcautious of overprotective.
Because that's the only egg that survives the attack. Because they had a whole bunch of.
Oh, now I just got sadder again.
For the longest time, I thought it was Billy Crystal. I thought Albert
Brooks was Monsters Inc.
Billy Crystal.
That's Monsters Inc.
But I never saw that one.
Oh, man. I've
never seen it.
It's good.
Do you watch movies?
Monsters University is good
not
too.
Really.
I like University. Yeah,
I haven't seen any of those.
Too busy watching Big Mama's House for the 17th time.
It's what I would say. Good. It's good enough for me. Okay, it's Saturday, Sunday, Monday. It's good. I got nothing to do.
I know
I'm
what happens
jobless.
In it. I don't need to watch a new movie.
Safe and comfortable. It's where I live.
Mm-hmm. I don't need a new thing.
Never. It's good enough.
I mean, Marlon would agree with you. You don't need a new thing. They have.
Is it the name of his dad?
Yeah, Marlon.
Okay. What's the name of the... I'm kidding. It's in the title. What's the name of the son?
What are we talking about?
Nemo.
Who is the forgetful fish, though?
Dory.
Oh.
You're the forgetful fish.
Just keep swimming.
Are you making fun of my
ADHD,
and
speaking of schools,
Brad?
I think Nemo is going to school?
Yep.
First day of school.
Because they have the yes,
that makes sense.
He gets on the school bus, which is a stingray with all the other kids.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
and he sings a song and floats around. And
just
then,
going to school. It's my first day.
Did he forget something? Like Albert Brooks, like forget to take your lunch.
Oh, maybe,
Nemo.
Probably.
No. Don't forget, mom's dead.
Don't forget, you're really sad because your mom's dead.
Did she die before he was?
Don't die.
Before he was like really
he said he was a little baby egg.
Yeah, he was an egg. And the egg gets like a crack on it, so he's got like a gimpy fin when he gets hatched.
Oh, I remember that. That's sad.
So they just had one kid?
Yeah.
Fish?
Instead of like 30.
30? Don't they have 30 kids? Don't they have 100 kids?
That sounds right.
There's fish.
There's Nemo 1, Nemo 7, Nemo 12. It's a lot of Nemos. There was like,
I mean, you lose one, you just grab the other one.
I mean, that was the idea, but then that barracuda came along and was like, gobble, gobble.
Oh, it ate all of them?
It's almost like a turkey at that point.
Yeah.
Is it a shark or a barracuda?
The shark shows up later.
The shark's later in this, yeah.
Oh.
It's just some evil fish.
Yeah, the bad fish.
Yeah.
Hmm.
It doesn't come back. There's no sort of closure to that
it's
one.
It's a little unfair, because I saw the opening of this movie twice in a row within one day, and that was miserable.
At theaters?
Oh, I told the story on the podcast already.
Tell it again for the show.
Yeah, well, it was like a half day at school, and first and second hour, I think, is all we had to go to, I believe, and then we went home, something like that.
And both of them just showed...
both teachers, first and second hour, like, we're going to watch a movie today.
Oh,
and you're like, yeah, a movie. And they're like, Nemo. Finding Nemo. I was like, okay, great, I'll watch it. And then the second hour is like, we're just going to watch a movie today.
You're like, yeah,
and it was like,
movie.
Finding Nemo. And I was like, are you kidding me?
Like,
I
teach,
literally
can we move
just
it forward
watched
like
this.
30 minutes.
This is the worst day of my life.
It was pretty miserable. To
like,
be honest.
Look, just teach me about history, please. I don't need this Nemo again.
That's like another time where I watched Jurassic Park 3, and then I went on a trip to Tennessee with like a bunch of kids, and it was on a bus, and they're like, we're gonna watch Jurassic Park 3, and I was like, no, like,
excuse me, I just saw that one, please change the movie.
Right,
that happened with me in Austin Powers, but it's always a joy to watch that movie, so I don't
know. Oh, that time. Movie's great.
I was like, just play it, yeah, keep it going.
Yeah, actually that was one of the movies I thought we should do at one point.
Yeah, we definitely need
we should
to
definitely write that
it's gonna,
on the
it's
list.
Gonna be up there.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, that one's great.
So what happens else in the... Does he come home? They have a fight?
They have like a... What gets him lost?
Nemo gets like... kicking in a current? Or a boat catches him.
He gets kidnapped. He swims off the shelf. They're like a coral in a coral shelf. And he like swims over the edge or whatever and is like... I don't know if he's just like, check out how death defying.
Yeah, never leave the coral was like something that Albert Brooks keeps saying.
And then a diver scoops him up. He's like, this would go great in my fish tank. Steals him.
Oh,
kidnapped.
Oh, yeah.
Fishnapped.
That happens like pretty early on?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He gone. He's dead.
Right.
No, he's not dead. He's not dead.
They're never going to find Nemo. Bad.
But he's, for all intents and purposes, that Albert Brooks should kind of just give up.
I mean,
you're a fish. You don't got a long lifespan.
It's pretty
here.
Big.
It's true.
The ocean.
You spend half your life trying to look for your son, and it's just 3 days. Come on.
I think he's trying to look for clues, though, and I think Dory like sees a fisherman with like she has some sort of
yes.
So Dory's
knowledge.
Helping Albert Brooks or
yeah
or
yeah.
Nemo.
So he chases the boat
Finding Nemo.
As far as he can until it flies away.
And she's a very forgetful fish.
Mm-hmm. She has no short term memory.
Why?
Because she doesn't.
It's just how she is.
It's just a movie funny thing to have a character.
I see.
Yep.
Yeah. There's like sad parts where like she tries to remember what she's doing, but like Albert Brooks or someone's like gone, and then she's like, I don't know where I am. I don't know what's going on.
She doesn't remember what she was supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
And gets terrified. She doesn't know where she is anymore.
It's
she's trapped.
That's her thing to overcome is like remembering things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
She has amnesia?
She has no short-term memory.
Yeah, it just has short-term memory loss. So she like resets every. Like,
we've told you this 17 times in this episode.
Andy, I'm worried about your short-term memory. 17
times of what?
Uh-oh. Who's that free? Forgetful
oh my
fish
gosh.
On this podcast.
I got a little fish brain. It works so well.
Will you quit it?
What?
Trying to swim here. What, the ocean isn't big enough for you or something like that?
Huh?
You got a problem, buddy? Huh? Huh? Do you? Want a piece of me? Yeah. Ooh, I'm scared now. What?
Wait a minute.
Stop following me, okay?
What are you talking about? You're showing me which way the boat went.
A boat? Hey, I've seen a boat. It passed by not too long ago. It went this way. It went this way. Follow me.
Wait a minute. What is going on? You already told me which way the boat was going.
I did? Oh, no.
If this is some kind of practical joke, it's not funny. And I know funny. I'm a clownfish.
No, it's not. I know it's not. I'm so sorry. See, I suffer from short-term memory loss.
Short-term memory loss. I don't believe this.
No, it's true. I forget things almost instantly. It runs in my family. Well, I mean, at least I think it does. Where are they? Can I help you?
Something's wrong with you. Really.
So
but you're right. She saw the address of the boat.
Or, yeah, some sort of name or the name of the boat. Or
yeah, she knows the address because she keeps reciting it.
She keeps saying it.
Yeah, over and
she's
over.
She's singing it at some point. Albert Brooks is like, where'd you hear? What's that name? Oh, the name of the boat that just went by.
Yeah.
Then Albert Brooks and her go on the journey.
He's
to
like,
find
oh,
Nemo.
You saw her. And the, like they start going. And then she loses her memory. And he's like, what? Wait, what's
hi, I'm Dory. What's going on?
And that's where he like finds
a
out.
Reoccurring
oh,
bit.
So then mm-hmm. he is also like he doesn't even know if she actually did even see the boat at this point. He's flipping out because his kid's gone. He's all mad,
mm-hmm.
right?
But he's like, well, I got, I guess, nothing else to go on. So they just keep on, keep swimming,
just keep swimming.
Where the seagulls come into play.
Later down the
later,
line.
Later, when they get to Australia.
We have a road trip adventure film
yep.
underwater. This is what this movie is.
That's true.
There's two fish trying to make it their way.
It's the road trip song.
You're not right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's Harry Nielsen from Midnight Cowboy.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Everybody's talking at me. I don't hear a word they're saying.
And then he dies on the bus on the way home.
We
anyway.
Gotta get you to the hospital.
I watched Midnight Cowboy in film school. That's the only time I ever watched it.
Oh, yeah. I watched it on my own. And I was like, why?
It's great.
It's but good, but
it's great.
Also
it's good, well-made but
it's
movie.
Heavy.
Yeah,
heavy.
It was on our list of movies to do, like wait, like when we first started the podcast.
Really?
Wow.
Wow.
That'd be
oh,
an
yeah.
episode.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Wow. That's like one of the first like X-rated movies. I
yeah.
Think
yeah.
That
no.
Wasn't a porn.
We'll go. We'll go direct from Finding
and it got
Nemo
an Oscar.
To
Midnight Cowboy. It was a real slingshot.
Yeah.
When the kids go to bed.
What we remember after dark.
So they meet a shark group. Is it just one shark, one big scary shark? Because in the poster,
sharks go with in groups, do they?
It's one shark
some,
but that
some
takes
do.
Them to a meeting of
it's
other
got,
sharks.
It's got a big mouth, like a big
oh, with all
teeth.
The teeth. Yeah, yeah.
But
yeah.
Are they like rehabilitating
yes,
sharks?
So the they gimmick? He takes them back to like this ship they live in, and he's like, oh god, this is all a trap. And then yeah, it turns out it's like Alcoholics Anonymous, but for sharks. They're like they've sworn off eating fish. And so it's like a support group mm-hmm. for them to like...
For the vegetarians now?
Yeah, they're vegetarian sharks.
That's
yeah.
funny.
But like something like there's like blood in the water at
yeah,
some point.
Yeah, I feel like someone like runs into a wall uh-huh. and some blood gets in the water and the sharks just go into a frenzy because mm-hmm. of it.
Makes sense.
And they have to outrun right. the sharks. And
yeah.
They, there's, I don't know if they get into like the drifts, the water drifts here or not, or how they end up getting away from the sharks, but...
Is yeah. that with the turtle though?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
right.
What
they
learn
to ride
the turtle
drifts.
To get the something something current.
But there's stuff before that where there's just like a big school of fish.
Yeah, that
like
talks
point,
to them as
yeah, they point their way
collectively.
Mm-hmm.
That yeah, that's like a
point them in directions and make
like
a Nemo.
They make fun of Marlin, yeah, yeah, for being grumpy.
They turn into him and like make him a sad face.
Yep. And then, but Dory's the nice one. She's like, "Oh, thanks, guys."
She's always looking on the bright side.
Oh yeah, he's always the grump and mm-hmm. upset, and she's just the nice one.
He's looking for his son.
She tries to talk to a whale using whale speak, which mm-hmm. is just talking like a
really
like
slow.
You sound like a whale. Yeah.
Not communicating at all.
Please tell me.
Does it work though? I think so. Yeah.
She's like, I speak whale. He's like, what?
That's speciesist.
Yeah, mammals and fish can't talk to each other. That's
good point.
That's a fact.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's just true.
Mm. Otherwise, I'd be talking to fish.
But it happens
all
later because you get the pelican. So we can flash to Nemo now because
well,
the
pelican just say mine.
No, the pelican is Australian. He talks to them.
Is it Paul
mine.
Hogan?
No,
down
I was
under?
Trying to think if it was like
Crocodile Dundee.
I was trying to think if it was like a Kiwi or Australian, we would know, but I don't know that it is.
Is the pelican picks him up in its mouth and like they swim in there?
The pelican
and...
is the bridge
that
connects
like
Nemo
like,
to Marlin at the end.
That's too much like Rescuers Down Under.
Down Under.
It kind of is.
Rescuers Down Under. So you're saying Finding Nemo is a retelling of Rescuers Down Under.
God damn it, Brad.
That
you
part.
Trapped me into this. This whole time was all a trick.
I think that part sounds similar, but I don't remember it.
It kind of
exactly.
is. Mm-hmm. It kind of is.
I like the mine pelicans. Those are fun. The ones I want to eat. They're not pelicans. They're just seabirds.
But yeah.
Seagulls. Rocks.
Seabirds.
Wait, which part?
Seagulls, seabirds?
Seagulls.
I don't know the difference.
I mean, seabirds are any birds on the sea, right?
Yeah. Seabird isn't a thing.
You're just trying to narrow it down. I'm just trying to be...
Seagulls are
I want to hit a shotgun buckshot so I know I'm right.
Yeah.
That's You're trying right. to narrow it down. You could be wrong. There could be a very specific kind of bird.
It's seagulls. They're seagulls.
Are there a flock of seagulls?
So,
because they're all by the dock, are there a flock right? of seagulls? And then they're like, mine.
On some,
mine.
Yeah, some rocks.
Mine.
I'm doing
mine.
A visual
mine.
Joke.
Mine. What do you see?
Flock of seagulls? Do it as flock of seagulls, Erica. Yeah.
I heard you say that.
Gorgeous.
And
sometimes
I heard that on the radio
podcast.
Today.
Wow.
Song. And I ran. I run so far away.
Is that song playing in this movie?
No.
No, but it played on the radio today.
Mm-hmm. So we have intercut scenes.
So we get the B plot
of Nemo hanging out in the.
Wakes up in a dentist's office.
Mm-hmm.
In a fish tank.
And Willem Dafoe is there.
Is
okay.
it? I thought it was Dennis Leary.
I think it's Willem Dafoe.
Oh, man, maybe.
We shall see.
Yeah.
By the seashore.
There's a bunch of them. There's a starfish. There's the puffer fish.
Seashells.
There's the angelfish with the scar. That's like the hardcore leader dude.
Shark bait. Ooh, ah.
Yeah.
They want to like feed it to a volcano or something?
It's his ritual to become a member of the
tribe.
Of the tank. Of the tribe, yeah.
Oh.
He has to walk through the ring of fire, which is like the little volcano in the fish tank that blows bubbles.
It looks fun.
Does he play dead? At one point?
Yes, I think yes.
Because he flushed out a toilet.
That's one of the strategies to get him to escape is he'll play dead and they'll scoop him out and
then
flush
put him in the he does go down the toilet. I'm pretty sure.
I don't know.
There's no salt water.
I think
there's
no. I think he plays dead, so they scoop him out and then he like jumps out of the thing after he's out because the pelican's supposed to help him escape because the pelican is like friends with the fish in the tank. He like shows up at the window and talks to them. During the day.
Oh. Okay. I do remember that part where he jumps out or he plays dead or I think
he does. Yeah, because I think the point
there.
Is that he's supposed to be a present for the dentist's niece who is like a little kid who kills fish.
Oh, it's like Spike in Toy Story.
So there's like a time limit.
It's like Spike in Toy Story.
Yeah, it's a remake of Toy Story.
This is a remake of Toy Story.
Happy 150th.
Oh, boy. So there's a time limit where they're like, oh, we have like 4 days to figure out how to like save
Nemo
from
out
getting
here.
Darla or whatever I think is the kid's name.
Hey, don't they have like tribal makeup on and stuff too?
Oh,
or like
sure.
they do some sort of like, they make little headdresses out of like the vines in the tank or something?
Yeah.
Something like that happens, yeah. They go through the ritual of him going in the volcano.
There's a shrimp in the tank, like a prawn or something that's like French.
Put it on the bobby.
I want to say.
Sacre bleu.
Right, just saying a lot of stuff.
French Australia, you know.
He said shrimp, I went for the thing, and then he corrected. Then I pivoted, Andy. It's called improvisation!
He's just yes
Brad's
Andy.
Been missing the podcast. Yes, he's had a lot of jokes stored
Someone's
away.
Gotta
This is all Brad has in his life, okay, Andy?
It's true. This is my outlet.
He needs this.
I need to get it out of there.
Okay. He definitely isn't also
imagine
playing
what
all his retro games.
Imagine what the world
out with
would
his
do.
Girlfriend. And all those good fun things, okay? You
know, I gotta get it out. I gotta
get it out.
Gotta get out the poison.
Get out.
Out.
You gotta get out just like Nemo had to get out of that tank.
Whoa! I like that segue back into the plot.
There we go.
That's how I like it. So we get them to get out and everything's good. So I think they meet up and there's still bad things happening, right? Or they're like, they just miss each other. Like Nemo just goes out and he goes into the tank or something, and because he talks to the people in the tank, I think.
I feel
like your son was just here.
I feel like they do their plan and it doesn't work or something. Like it fails,
I think Nemo gets out, then he gets stuck. I think they'll switcheroo.
You'll
gift to the Magi.
Maybe because the pelican runs into
Dory
and Marlin at one point. From the seagulls or something.
Seabirds.
But he finds out, and they're like, they mention the name Nemo, and he's like, oh, I know who that kid is, and has to convince them to like ride in his mouth. And Marlin's like, no, you're just gonna eat us, you idiot.
He's like, oh, I won't.
But that's when the seagulls show up, and they're like, grr in the mouth, so we cannot get killed by seagulls.
Yes,
mine.
Right, because they're trying to get to the water, but the seagulls are all attacking.
So the seagulls are trying to eat the fish, and the pelican's trying to get them to Nemo. And they, like, fly around, and, I don't know, he runs into the window of the dentist's office. Like, they closed it for once, so he can't fly in. I don't know. Hmm. I can't remember how they joined back up. You're right, like, because they have a plan.
Mm-hmm.
Stick to the plan.
Hmm. It's not like it's a crucial part of the film or anything, I'm sure.
Yeah. They meet up again at some
point.
Were
they looking for Nemo? I don't remember.
They're trying to find him.
Are you sure?
I feel.
Hmm.
But there
Here we go again. This is what we remember about Finding Nemo.
Man.
I know Dory gets split up because it's sad because she, like, you feel like she's just going to leave the quest because she can't remember anything.
Yeah, like and Marlon basically.
But then she remembers Nemo. She starts to remember things.
Yeah.
She remembers Nemo. She even remembers Marlon.
She manages to remember enough.
What was going on. She goes back on her quest. Yeah.
Hmm. I remember the ending very well.
I've only seen this movie like twice, maybe.
I think same.
For sure once.
Yeah, this is probably one of the ones I've watched the least.
I watched the opening probably
the opening 17 times.
And then the whole movie once.
That sounds right. Yeah, that checks out.
Just the saddest part of the movie. Just watch it over and over again.
The setup. Why do I just want to watch the setup to a movie?
Well, you can skip the setup in this one. I give you permission. You start 15 minutes into the movie.
Oh, well, no. I watched the whole thing because it's been so long. That was like 2003 when it came out.
Yeah.
Or four.
Yeah, I think three is right.
Yeah. Three is when it came out, but it might have been three or four.
It was a hot movie when it came out, man.
Oh, man. Pixar was knocking them out, man. They had like six in a row that were all huge hits.
High-quality kids films?
Toy Story, Bug's Life was big. Toy Story 2. This one was, I think, fourth for them. I think their fourth film.
Monsters, Inc.
Is that before this?
Yeah. Okay. 2001, I think, Monsters, Inc.
Yeah.
There were like a 2 or 3 year like separation between Pixar films for a minute there. You get one every other year.
Pete Docter did Monsters, Inc. And then
that was like 2000.
So yeah, this was
Bug's
right
Life
after.
Was 98.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Toy Story was definitely 95.
I think up until Good Dinosaur, I'd seen every Pixar movie in a theater.
Yeah.
Good Dinosaur? I what is that?
Exactly.
Andy. Is that a Pixar movie?
Is it?
I think it is.
I think it is.
What? I've never
heard of it. There's a movie called The Good Dinosaur, and then there's a movie called Dinosaur, and they're both CGI dinosaur movies.
Dinosaur is not... That's a DreamWorks movie, I think.
Okay.
I don't even know. Good Dinosaur? Man. I've never heard of that. That's a...
Nobody wanted to see Good Dinosaur.
When did it come out?
2012 or something?
Well, yeah, that sounds about right around then. It was later, but...
It was their first dud.
Never heard of it.
I guess that's true because Cars 2 was bad, but it pulled in a lot of money because all the kids love Cars. To see that.
I saw it
at the Dollar Theater.
Yeah. All the kids love Cars.
Cars 2 or Cars?
Cars.
Okay, Cars 2 is just an insane train wreck of a movie, but...
Not a car wreck of a movie?
You wish.
It was.
It is a truck wreck. But, no.
So Nemo and the dad get along and live happily ever after, and Dory's there too, and then there's a sequel.
Yes. The end. So yeah, they escape. They all get back. Dory becomes part of their family, sort of.
Yeah.
And
but there's no like sexual tension between.
Oh yeah, no, not at all.
The clownfish and the whatever she is.
Yeah. She. Yeah. And
species don't mix.
So
Brad.
I'm trying to think. So like the growth is like Marlin learns to like experience all these new things and understand that like the ocean's a cool place even if it is scary and that he needs to let Nemo
live his own
life. His own life basically.
Fair enough.
Yeah, you can't you know
yep.
keep him sheltered. He needs to go experience.
Dory
things.
Learns that she can sometimes remember things, and Nemo doesn't learn anything. He's just the same. I don't know if that's true or not.
He gets brave. Yeah. I guess you know. Does he use his little fin for any? Does that help or hurt him in any way? Is it just a unique thing that's in the characteristic?
Man, that's a good question. I feel like it comes into play. It's definitely part of when they're asking people if they've seen their kit, like Nemo, that I feel does one little fin on one side or something. Oh, there's a scene like where he gets caught in a fishing net. I think.
Is that what the boat? Early on?
No. This is like the whole school of fish ends up in there, and he like gets them all to swim in one direction to break the net or something.
Oh, that's fun. That is true. Yeah, he pulls the boat down.
Like, I feel like the gimpy net. I feel like his gimpy fin comes into play for that or something. Like he can't swim hard enough. I don't know.
I see.
Maybe I'm wrong.
Well, we'll find out what we got right when we got wrong.
Yeah,
part
let's
two.
Go watch this one, I guess, and see. Find out who that forgetful fish was.
Do you have anything to add?
Yeah, I do know that like fish aren't really
about the movie.
Real? Fish aren't real?
Actually, no. Fish aren't really technically real. Like the idea.
Whoa!
Of
it's like the birds.
Yeah.
Well,
they're all robots.
What I mean by that is
There's nothing. There's no fish.
There's no such thing as fish. Like there's mammals. There's reptiles, but fish aren't really a good classification.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah.
You can't just
because
get a fish.
There are certain fish in the ocean that are more associated with land animals than they are with other fish in the ocean.
Interesting. Okay.
So there's a whole book by someone who's a Radiolab contributor or host. And she wrote a book called Why Fish Don't Exist. And it was all about this guy in the 1800s who classified and named things as fish. He was kind of like trying to be like Darwin in a way, but he had no like scientific like understanding about fish. He just was like, we need to classify things.
Making some shit up.
Fish
facts. It was all about classifying things. So he was just like, we'll classify fish. But yeah, there are definitely like a bunch of different types of fish that aren't really.
There's fish sticks. There's fish nuggets.
Yep.
There's
fish sticks.
there's filet of fish.
Fish sticks.
Love a fish stick. Put one in my mouth right now.
But yeah, I wanted to read that book because it sounded interesting. But it was all about classification of fish and
how it's messed up.
It's totally messed up. Yeah.
That's cool.
She was saying there are some fish that are more related to cows than they are to other fish.
Moo.
Yeah.
And this one's related to a clown.
That's right, the manatee.
Like looking at
the sea cow.
Well, they would look at DNA, DNA sequence, and go, well, these aren't technically related. Hmm. It's more related to this creature.
What the hell's a jellyfish? What the hell is that?
Yeah.
What is that then?
Even that's called a fish.
What is that? That's not a fish.
Fish, it's just a pile of jelly that fell in the
water. Where's the peanut butter fish?
That's a good question.
The sandwich fish.
How do they find each other to make
the bread fish?
Seahorse? Is that a horse?
It's a horse.
What is that?
In the sea?
What is that thing?
It's majestic.
Is that a fish? Seahorse. That thing's wild.
I don't like it. I don't trust it. Wait, swims? I don't like that.
Like, where are you going? Is that a chess piece? Is that a chess piece?
Well, we're gonna see what we got right and we got wrong in part two of Finding Nemo, 150th episode.
Ha ya!
It's like a Zelda sound effect.
Ha ya!
Hello, my name is Bruce.
Hello, Bruce.
It has been 3 weeks since my last fish, on my honour, or may I be chopped up and made into soup.
You're an inspiration to all of us.
I mean.
Right then, who's next?
Oh, pick me.
Yes, the little Sheila down the front.
Woo!
Come on up here.
Hi, I'm Dory.
Hi, Dory.
And, well, I don't think I've ever eaten a fish.
Hi, that's incredible.
Good on you, mate.
I'm glad I got that off my chest.
Welcome back to the Fish Are Friends, Not Food podcast. We watch Finding Nemo.
Did I tell the story about how I watched it twice in school?
Yep.
Well, same stuff happened. I watched the first 45 minutes and then I was like, okay, it's getting late. Let me turn it off. I'll come back to this. And then I was at my girlfriend's house and I was like, oh yeah, I have to watch Finding Nemo for the podcast.
And she was like, I'm not going to watch it from the beginning.
Yeah, so she started from the very beginning and I was like, once again.
One more time. The curse of the Finding
Nemo.
You
can't escape it. I'm annoyed by just the beginning and I don't find it funny, but later on in it, I'm like, oh, I get into this. It's funny.
This movie is sad.
Oh, it is
sad.
It's just down. Bad thing happens after bad thing happens.
Is it more like Homeward Bound, or kind of worked through?
Marlin can't catch a break.
Yeah. Is it more like Homeward Bound or more like Land Before Time?
Well, Homeward Bound seems like it's like on a direction of being found, right?
I think my quote from when we did Homeward Bound was like, if you have like, 100 minutes to watch a movie there where nothing really happens, like, watch this one. Like, I mean, this movie is sort of Homeward Bound, but it's so compelling. I don't know. It's funny, reading the synopsis for this film, it sounds like the dumbest, most boring movie you've ever heard of. They're like, a fish, his kid gets kidnapped, he's in a fish tank, and then the other fish swims a while.
In the fish tank for an hour.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you have to basically make it a road trip movie.
It is a road trip movie.
Yeah, it is.
Right? You have to run into other characters. Mm-hmm.
Learn new things about yourself.
Along the way.
But
what did we learn? Marlin learns to let go.
He learns to be
non-overbearing.
Overly
because
protective.
Because of his trauma of losing his wife
and his entire family.
All of his other children. He's overly protective of Nemo.
Yes.
And he knows, too, Nemo has like that one fin, which we forgot about.
He's got the strong fin.
Lucky flipper.
He's got the lucky flipper.
The strong fin.
Let me use my strong fin. Is that his voice?
Yeah. You'll see the clip.
Help!
here.
Oh,
take my hand.
Ah,
come on. You're gonna fall unless you take my hand.
No, give me your other hand.
Oh, my other hand isn't strong enough. You take my little hand.
No, get it away from me.
Thank you.
So he has to learn to relax and let go and let his son not be overprotective of his child.
Yeah, basically let Nemo like explore and grow. On his
right, because even Dory does that when like they're swimming down into the darkness. She's kind of like, "Let's go down." He's like, "Well, we can't see anything." He's like, "I don't know. Let's just try it."
Yeah,
yeah. Dory's just like, "I'll just go for it."
Or they run into the sharks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
which I thought was a funny bit.
The sharks are good.
This is all like there's so many bits.
Bruce
in this
the shark.
I really chuckled. Yeah, Bruce the shark is hilarious. Like
I forgot it took place in Australia, off the coast of Australia.
I did too, yes. Because you see the Sydney Opera House,
mm-hmm. yep.
where the dentist is working, and that's where the
T. Sherman while we weigh Sydney.
Yeah,
huh?
The address for the
address
dentist
that Dory keeps saying over and over again.
Oh, okay.
It also means fisherman. P. Sherman is supposed to be like fisherman.
P. Sherman,
yeah,
like with a PH.
Yeah.
Oh,
Sherman.
I don't know if that works, but no, I don't think that works. But
take that,
enough.
Pete Doctor. Go back to medical school.
The stakes.
This was Andrew Stanton, wasn't it? I think this is Andrew Stanton. Yeah. Doctor did the one before this.
Yeah, but
my joke
doesn't work if it's not him.
That's fair. So. I'm here to ruin your joke, so don't worry about it.
Actually, if you look at the credits,
oh,
you'll find
you know
that.
That's actually.
I think, but.
The director did the voice of the turtle.
He did. And the next
the
director
fun.
Did his son. Brad Bird did his Crush's kid.
Oh.
I think.
I thought that sounded like a kid's voice.
Yeah.
Wow!
Yeah, he was 8 when he made it.
Turns out,
oh!
He's a talented voice actor.
He directed the other movie at 10.
Yeah, Iron Giant when he was in the womb.
Yeah, you got to start somewhere.
Yeah,
I like the. I kind of forgot, but I like the stakes of the 4-year-old girl is coming to pick up the fish,
yeah.
Darla, which that, means death.
She's got those braces.
Oh mm-hmm. man, mm-hmm. terrifying!
Mm-hmm.
Just her opening the door.
Yeah,
and it's like darkness.
Okay.
It's so well shot.
It's scary.
I feel like the writing is pretty tight for this film. Like they get a lot accomplished.
I mean, they just take Toy Story and just change it a little bit, right?
Yeah, kind of. They take Toy Story 2 and kind of change it up a bit. It's more of what it is almost.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like, now I hadn't even thought about it. But that's almost exactly what this movie is. But it's so like when he first meets Dory and like she's like, I know where it is, follow me, and like introduces the whole mechanism of her memory where she's just suddenly like, oh, this creep's following me. What
oh,
the
yeah, fuck? Yeah.
Like that's hilarious.
Yeah. Does she explain that she has a short memory, but then he ignores what she's explaining and then she doesn't
Believe her the first time. Like he thinks she's just being like a weirdo, like being mean to him or something. And then she forgets that she told him again.
She has no short-term memory.
And he gets mad.
But she does learn the name, the address. She memorizes that.
Right.
See, that was another funny one where like she
remembers
looking, they
the more
sharks if they can read human language.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like the memory issue isn't that much of an issue once she's always with, what was the guy?
Marlin.
Once she's always with him, the memory issue isn't an issue. But once they finally separate,
the saddest moment,
dude.
You won't even remember me, Dory.
And he just
disappears. Dips on her.
Yeah. Albert Brooks impersonation.
She just traveled halfway around the world. She doesn't remember where the hell she is. Like that's horrifying. Like oh my god.
Yeah. I mean, how does he even make it back? You're in the open water. How are you supposed to know where you're going in the first place?
I think he's just so downtrodden that he's just
lost it all.
He doesn't care anymore.
It. He's downriver.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Some notes, actually.
Oh, Andy wrote some notes.
Oh, it's in notes, eh?
Well, it's our first Pixar film. I had to show up, you know?
Andy loves Pixar.
I do.
This is really our first Pixar movie? We didn't do anything else?
Like, Pixar movie.
First one.
Pixar?
I mean, everyone knows Toy Story 2 well.
Yeah.
So we can't do that.
You do Bug's Life.
Bug's Life is just Seven
Bug's
Samurai.
Life. Well, yeah. That's why it's good.
I've actually seen Bug's Life.
Have you seen Seven
Samurai?
Parts
of it. I haven't. That's one I need to watch.
This movie, well, not the same. So it's kind of interesting. So the story kind of gets borrowed from Toy Story 2, and the visuals are sort of borrowed from Bug's Life. Because the whole idea with Bug's Life was that they could use the CG tech they had at the time, lended itself really well to showing sort of this shrunken from the bottom up kind of world and plant life, seeing through all these plants and this vegetation and all these bugs. And so Nemo's the same idea, but underwater. It's like this lends itself really well to what they could do at the time with their technology. And like you get to see the coral, the reefs and all that stuff. It looks really cool.
Yeah, the animation looked actually pretty good compared to what I thought it might
Bruce
look like.
Bruce the Shark, I think, looks so good. Like, when he starts going nuts and, like, or even when he's just laughing and he's like, ha ha, and his whole mouth is, like, flopping and you see
who
all
was that
teeth.
Actor? I couldn't tell. Oh. I mean, he's
Paul
doing
Hogan, I think. Call that a shark.
I think
shark.
That was the joke we made in part
I saw a shark. That's a shark.
Oh, my God. Let me see.
Never live that quote down.
Mm-hmm. Oh, what's this Paul movie Hogan? Called? Finding Nemo?
Wow. No one knows who that is.
Who? Oh, Wingdings?
Man. Wingding Numdums.
What was your favorite part overall? Piece of...
I like when Nemo has one good, like, overcome moment where he, like, goes back into the thing to put the pebble in. Yeah. It's like the one, like, uplifting part of the film.
Yeah.
Everything else is just, like, so depressing and, like, everyone's failing.
Yeah.
And then Nemo finally gets sure. a W. Puts that pebble in that thing.
That honestly,
what was the motivator again for that?
So that's we should kind of get into it because we were like sort of trying to piece together the plots from the aquarium,
right?
Of like their plan. So their plan was to clog the filter, which they needed Nemo to do.
He needed to go in through the fan and then
put a pebble
in there,
in the thing.
And then they would pull him out the other side with some fake seaweed.
Yeah.
And then what would happen is the filter's not working, so that they knew the dentist would have to take all of them individually out of the tank.
And they would roll across.
They would roll Frogger, out the window.
Frogger style across the street.
Yes. Right.
Into the
ocean.
Right.
Which
right.
Was right.
Exactly.
There.
Which they got really close to that, but then everything
the dentist
up.
Got a super awesome filter that like cleaned the thing.
He bought a filter that didn't require him to actually take all the fish out.
Yeah, well, because they attempted the first time and Nemo almost dies trying to do this.
Right.
And so they're like,
and Willem Dafoe was like, I'm never gonna do that again.
I thought it was Dennis Leary or something.
Which,
be right.
Willem Dafoe was my favorite. That was my favorite character.
I like the little French shrimp,
the angelfish. Yeah.
Oh, the shrimp was good.
Yeah, the cleaning shrimp.
I don't know why. I just like Willem Dafoe a lot, and he was my favorite part. He was very serious.
I mean, the whole all the fish in there. Like Allison Janney is the starfish. She's really funny.
Everybody loves Raymond.
Who's Brad Garrett?
Loves Raymond.
I said that in part one.
No.
You did say it, yeah.
You got to call him Everybody Loves Raymond.
Yeah.
Raymond.
Raymond. Stephen Root is the Bubbles fish. That's right.
Bubbles.
I saw that in the IMDb and I was like, oh, of course.
Yeah,
like,
he loves Bubbles.
Yeah.
Not my Bubbles.
All the fish in there
He's
are
a good
just really well
actor.
Done.
Mm-hmm. My Bubbles.
Bildo tree. Yeah.
My Bubbles.
But yeah, like, so they abandon the plan and they're like, it's not worth the risk. Like, we shouldn't do this. And it's the story of Marlin and Dory, like, travels around the world faster than they do. Like, some animal hears it, and then there's, like, the montage of all these other animals telephoning the story all the way through.
It's literally a big fish story.
Yes. Until until the pelican hears it.
But it's real, though. A big fish story is a lie.
Well, it just gets exaggerated over and over again.
Yeah, all their crazy things that they've overcome gets, like, bigger and bigger.
Oh, I thought they were just telling what actually happened, but maybe you're right. I might be misremembering.
They might have just said it as accurately as possible. But
it made him, like, it made Nemo go, like, oh, my dad is coming to get me.
Yeah, the pelican tells him, he's like, hey, like, your dad is actually coming to find you, and that's when Nemo's like, all right, let's do it, and, like...
That's when he puts the pebble in there.
Yeah. That's what gets him to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And then it works. That's another one of my favorite bits, too, is when the like tank's getting gross and the shrimp, they have to keep telling him to stop cleaning it. He's just like, I'm sorry. It's hard. He's like a tank cleaning fish.
Yeah.
It's just so funny.
My favorite part, too, is like because they all were in the dentist's office, they're like, talking about dentist gear. They're like, oh, what do you think he's going to use for that?
Yeah, everyone's so excited about
we got a root canal. What do you think he's going to use? This?
Yeah.
They're all like expert in dentistry.
Even the bird that kept coming in to watch.
It's like a show. It's one thing they have in life to watch.
Yeah, exactly. Right. It's like the one moment where like that's their version of the zoo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They're watching humans.
Zoo.
Yeah.
It's like a Twilight Zone.
It's like when you watch like... them like feed a animal at the zoo. It's like, oh wow, we got a root canal today.
Yeah, we had most of the set pieces. The fish in the net thing happens, but Dory's the one that gets trapped in the net. It's the final moment of tension in the story after they rescue Nemo, and you're like, oh, everything is saved. So Dory gets snatched.
Those fish look so weird, too.
Yeah, they're the creepiest fish in the movie.
Oh, my God. They look real.
And they learn that from the tank when the dentist is coming in to scoop up the fish. They swim down
to make
it's just a big net.
So Nemo applies his knowledge.
Yeah. Tells them everyone to swim down.
And they do it, and they save Dory and crush Nemo.
Yep, and everyone on that boat drowns. And
okay, so here's another contender for me for my favorite moment is right after they free Dory, and like Nemo is like half conscious on the ground, and Marlin swims over and tells him he's like, I met a sea turtle. And it's like a really good callback to the beginning. That scene is really, really good. Yeah, he's like, but that fish only said they live to 100. And he's just like, do you think they know better than me? I swam across the whole damn ocean.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's a really good cap of Marlin's growth as a dad through the film. I really enjoy that moment.
He finally gets to tell his clownfish joke at the end that he has trouble telling.
Nails it.
But yeah.
The rest of the whole, because you're a clownfish, right? Tell a joke.
It's a funny bit. Yeah, it's funny.
And I like it.
I mean, maybe it's a little too obvious as a joke.
Yeah.
But it's funny.
It's a kid's movie, though, too. Yeah, so it makes sense. But, man,
you can easily forgive it. It does show growth.
Too. Also, that school that loses Nemo, they should be sued.
Ooh, that's a good
Marlin
point.
Should put a case.
Some liability.
Liability
on them,
for losing my son.
On a field trip. Yeah. Did he sign a permission slip? I didn't see it.
To the edge or whatever.
Exactly.
Yep.
Mm-mm. Exactly.
Man.
And then, I mean, come on, if you go over to a fish, they're bolt away. He couldn't swim at all.
He's got a little gimpy fin. He can't do nothing.
A little gimpy fin? What the heck's that all about?
Man.
How's he surviving?
Yeah.
That barracuda. Bump that egg.
Barracuda.
Man. It's crazy thinking about how huge this movie was when it came out.
Oh, so much money. So everyone wanted to see it. But it was just so sad.
Yeah.
This movie's a sad
this
movie.
This movie kind of launched Ellen DeGeneres back into the spotlight.
She was in a TV show.
Well, she was.
She had her show.
Do you remember the history of that show?
Yeah.
Because she came out on the show and the ratings
tanked
afterward.
Yeah. Like the fish tank this movie.
And then she wasn't in another I don't know what she was in after that, but I don't think she had anything big or major until
kind of her talk show has been on for 20 years.
Well, it's off the air now. But
it was
her talk show was
years, though.
It was on after this movie came out, though.
Mm-hmm.
It was like a year or two after.
So yeah, this could be sort of a kickstart for that. Because she does a very good job as Dory.
Her stand-up in the 90s was really funny. I saw her in a lot of Comedy Central stuff. She was funny.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah,
she just came out at a time when people weren't ready for that.
Mm-mm.
Even though it was 1997 or 8.
Oh no,
figured out.
They were like, no way.
Yeah, but yeah, this I think it was the trivia. Someone else was talking this movie was highest grossing animated film at least for the year. It knocked off Lion King, which is the previous record holder, until the next year whatever the next film.
Shark Tales.
They re-released Lion King and made all the money back.
Incredibles,
Lion King
broke
one and a half. Remember that?
But
they re-released Lion King.
But they made Lion King 1.5. You remember?
Straight to DVD though, no?
No, I think it came out in the theater.
Mm.
Is that the Timon and Pumbaa side or is that a third one?
There's a third one as well, but I think 1.5.
I thought 1.5 is from Timon and Pumbaa's side. It was
I don't remember the reason why they called it 1.5, but I think it was actually released in the theater.
It could be.
It was a Guildenstern and whatever. It's side
Rosencrantz.
Story. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, but Lion King with Timon and Pumbaa. That's what it was.
Okay.
I don't even know what that is. Is that a cartoon? I've heard that before. Names.
No, it's like Hamlet viewed from their point of view. That's what that is.
Hmm.
And this is Lion King viewed from their point of view.
Oh.
Because because Lion King, I don't know if you know, is based off Hamlet. It was based off Hamlet.
Sure.
It wasn't the other way around.
It was based off Romeo and Juliet.
Shakespeare didn't see Lion King and then write Hamlet. It was the other way around.
Everything's based off of Shakespeare.
I didn't see it in the trivia.
Yeah. I should put that in the trivia. It's even sticks. Shakespeare did not see Lion King before writing Hamlet.
Yeah. But if you guys had a guess... How much
12.
This gross?
200 and... Nope, that's too low.
Worldwide gross.
$485 million.
$700 billion dollars.
Nothing's ever made that much money.
$700 million.
You were close. Over $800 million. Yeah. Dollars. Wow. This almost hit the $1 billion mark.
What was the first
in 2003? Four?
Yeah, that's pretty huge. Big.
That's crazy.
That's big.
What was the first movie to hit the B? Hit the big old B.
Billion. Titanic?
Gone with the Wind.
Oh, Titanic makes sense. Yeah.
What about Gone with the
Titanic, if you just for inflation. Yeah.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
I meant what you said.
Gone with the Wind.
For inflation. Yeah, yeah, that could be.
Well, because there was like, what, four movies out that year when that movie came out?
Maybe made a million. Maybe it came close and didn't get there.
A million or a billion? You said a million.
Right. I meant a billion. I'm just screwing my words so bad right now.
And I don't know if this is actually still the case. The article is a few years old, but Kurt holds the record for most DVD sales.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Period. Most successful DVD release of all time.
Yep.
Well, also, I mean,
I wanted it.
DVD kind of has like
with a full screen and a widescreen.
Like, right. That record kind of ends at a point when no one buys DVDs.
To come out, so, it's kind of like
it drops off. I'm sure, like that's
And that's only like 6 years into DVDs, so maybe that's the peak.
Like that's crazy.
It was a great DVD. It lasted.
And it's a kids movie. Of course, you're gonna want the DVD for your kids.
Yeah. $30 at Target.
Let's keep replaying this movie.
All this was a really long way for me to get to the point of which movie knocked this off the number one slot in its second week. Because it's a movie.
Animated movie?
Oh.
Dear to me, and I hope to do it on the podcast
2003?
Someday.
When did Nemo come out?
It's a sequel.
X-Men 2?
A sequel.
It's near and dear to you, so that's not
Is it an animated movie or not?
Not an animated
movie. Fast, Too Furious.
It is Too Fast, Too Furious.
That was good. That was good, Brad.
I was like,
near and dear to you.
We hungry for DVD sales.
The whole first movie is about stealing DVDs. Makes sense.
There you go.
You wouldn't steal this DVD.
You wouldn't copy this floppy.
I think
steal a car. I mean, that's the whole movie.
I stole a car yesterday.
It's gone in 60 seconds. We're just about to watch it.
Oh,
that's the whole premise.
That's a movie we need to do.
We do need to do that movie. Okay.
I think that's what we're doing next.
That'd be good.
Nicolas Cage movie.
Yeah.
Well, my one bleep
during
Finding Nemo.
We'll do 8mm and snake eyes.
Throw that explicit tag on the Nemo episode.
Thanks a lot, Andy.
What the f***, Andy?
Oh, boy.
Oh, man. That's pretty good. But, yeah.
I don't got anything else to talk about. I just was sad the whole time.
I mean, it's sad for sure.
It never
sure,
made
but
me happy. I was so sad.
Not even when
Albert Brooks is such like a somber voice.
He has a really good voice for that.
They got back together at the end.
But they do.
It's not my favorite Pixar movie.
This movie really does kind of solidify that formula where that they kind of pilot with Toy Story 2 of like the really hit you in the feels. Like you can be dark and bring it back, and it can still be a really successful kids movie that really worked for them for another decade almost.
Yeah.
Just I think knocking out hits after hits.
Up was a better one for me.
I mean, WALL-E's still my favorite.
Up has the saddest moment of any Pixar film the first 10 minutes.
Oh, God.
Yeah. Oh, it's so well put together, though.
My heart can't take it.
So well put together.
Yeah.
My heart sometimes can't take a Pixar film.
Dude, Inside Out has like the moment when the imaginary guy disappears. Oh, my God. That destroyed me in the theaters.
I don't remember it very well. Wreck-It Ralph doesn't have any sad moments.
I haven't seen that one. That's Disney, though. It's not Pixar, I think.
Son of a B.
What about Wreck-It Ralph 2?
Coco's got a really good.
Was good.
Disappears. Oh man,
Coco was good.
Hit you in the feels.
So man,
I never saw Brave.
What was the other movie that just came
Encanto?
Out last year? Encanto. That felt like Coco.
We don't talk about Bruno.
I mean,
Andy.
It had that one song.
We don't talk about Bruno.
That the girl who's like can lift up everything. Mm-hmm. That song is really good. That's probably one of the best songs ever written for a
really good
for a Pixar movie. I feel.
Surprised that it did. Was that one the one that was up for
it was
song?
Nominated but something else won.
Yeah,
I don't remember.
Yeah, Lin-Manuel's gotta wait for that EGOT another year.
He's
Moana didn't win.
He's young.
Nope.
No, he's just missing that Oscar, right?
Yep. The Oscar's the one thing he'll get a PGOT because I think he has a Pulitzer too already.
Yeah, maybe. He's fine, he's young,
but whatever.
A PGOT. What if he PGOT?
What if he gets
is there an L prize so he can get a Piglet?
Yeah, Nobel Prize. Nobel Prize.
What about a Piglet?
Nobel Prize.
He gets a Lifetime Achievement Award and gets a Piglet?
Oh, there, yeah. That's pretty good.
I was trying to figure out which letter I was missing in my head.
Yeah. Encanto, I mean, I know a ton of people that love Encanto. It's amazing. It was very good, but I was also sort of like,
I gotta watch it.
It's fine. I mean, there's a lot of other films I'd watch over it. But
I was saying, it felt like Coco, actually. It felt like Coco in some ways.
It did. I mean, it also takes place in Latin America, so maybe that's just, you're being insensitive is on.
Ooh.
Got him. I actually fell asleep during it, so I don't even know what happened.
Wow.
I just know the opening.
It's it's very good. But I also never saw Frozen 2. Like, there's a lot of other movies I've been missing a lot of.
Frozen or Frozen 2?
I saw Frozen 1, but I don't know. It's, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't seen.
They've still been very good films.
I just haven't sat down and watched any Pixar movies. So when I have a kid, I can sit down and then watch all
of them. I do think their two most visually stunning films are Coco and Encanto. I think they're most incredibly colorful. Well, it's not even about the effect, how good the effects are. It's just the colors and like the production design in both those films is really cool.
Yeah, but because of that, too, I think it's. And the quality of the animation these days.
I'm sure that helps.
Astounding. So I think it's just going to get more and more like that.
Could be.
But, you know,
some good stuff.
Thank you for joining us on that episode and every episode that you do. The next movie we're doing has the tagline, "It's everybody's non-pollutionary, anti-institutionary, pro-confectionary factory of fun." We remember Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Dear friends, you are now about to enter the nerve center to the entire Wonka factory. Inside this room, all of my dreams become realities, and some of my realities become dreams. Boys and girls, the chocolate room. Come with me, and you'll be in a world of pure imagination. Take a look, and you'll see into your imagination.
What is this, Wonka? Some kind of fun house?
Why, having fun? We are the music makers. And we are the dreamers of dreams.
How did you like the chocolate factory, Charlie?
I think it's the most wonderful place in the whole world.
All aboard, everybody.
So shines a good deed in a weary world.
This is kind of strange.
Yes, but it's fun.
Charlie, don't forget what happened to the man who suddenly got everything he always wanted.
What happened?
He lived happily ever after.